We are able to get to this point because we have made so many friends and partners and collaborators, and we have all our experts coming up. You know, this morning you have heard a few, and we have more for you this afternoon. And it is with great pleasure that I will introduce Dr. Hamadani. And you know, she is such a humble lady. She's the pioneer of the International Research Organization in ICDDRB. I asked her for how she'd like to be introduced. Oh, just say that I am the head of the International Research Organization, ICDDRB. No, you're not. No, she is the pioneer in the research in early childhood development in Bangladesh. Okay, and so that's all she wants me to introduce her. But let me tell you, she's a wonderful person. And she will share with us what she knows after all these years of her experience. So without much ado, I'll invite Dr. Hamadani, because you know we're always running short of time. So, Dr. Hamadani.
Thank you, Christy, for a very nice and generous introduction. I know it's in the afternoon and you have all had lunch, and I know everybody is falling a bit sleepy. The good thing is that our chair happens to be a good singer, so I have asked her to, if she finds people are falling asleep, she could start singing for us. And in fact, our previous speakers in the morning, including the Right Honorable Prime Minister, they have set the bar so high that I'm afraid I may disappoint you at this point. But anyway, we'll give it a try. And so I'm going to talk about multidisciplinary approach to address nutrition and health. I would be singing to the core here because I know everybody knows so much about ECD, but nevertheless, I'm going to talk a little bit about it. We all know that development is multifactorial. There are many, many factors that affect development, like nutrition. We all know that exclusive breastfeeding improves development of children. We all know that malnutrition in any different category, like undernutrition, iron deficiency, iodine deficiency, and many other nutritional deficiencies, they cause developmental delay. So nutrition is one of the most important factors that affects development of the children. We know health is another factor. Children who are suffering from, like, birth asphyxia, children who are suffering from epilepsy, cerebral palsy, even like if a child is suffering from chronic suppurative otitis media, the child may be found to have difficulty in hearing, impairment in hearing, and that would affect development of the child. Vitamin A deficiency could affect seeing the child, sight of the child, and that would further delay development. So there are a lot of health factors that affect development of the children. Then of course we know socioeconomic status will affect children's development. Poverty is one major factor that affects development. Psychosocial stimulation, we all agree that anybody that decides this here, that psychosocial stimulation improves children's development? I hope not. And intrauterine condition, the condition of the mother, nutritional status of the mother, mental health of the mother, of the whole family, preconception situation, all affect a child's development. And of course, the last but not the least is the love and care and safety and security that happens in the child's life. These are all affecting a child's development. So we all know that almost 43% of the children under 5 years in low and middle income countries are not attaining their developmental potentials. The adversities before conception and throughout the prenatal and early life, they are affecting the development of the brain of the child. There are many services, but the services are of varying quality, and there is not quite much of coordination among them, so there isn't even equitable access, and that is going to affect children's development. And of course, we have heard this morning about nurturing care, and we know that children's early development requires nurturing care and parent and family interactions, and they need an environment that enables these interactions. So you have seen this slide in the morning, the domains of nurturing care. I'm going to talk about health and nutrition here, but I may touch a little bit on some other factors also. So about health, I have got two different documents. One from the ECD Action Network that was just hot from the oven. It was in the G20 forum document, and also the Nurturing Care of WHO in this year. And they all talked about care during pregnancy, routine antenatal care and health checkups. They talk about birth attendance, field birth attendance, about immunization, prevention of maternal stress and depression, and then hygiene, water, sanitation, and the nurturing care also talks about monitoring children's physical and emotional condition, talking about giving affectionate and appropriate responses to children's early needs, protecting young children from household and environmental dangers. There are a lot of environmental toxicants like lead, arsenic, cadmium that is affecting children's development, indoor air pollution, smoking, secondhand smoking, all of these are affecting children's development. And I think they have covered almost both of these. And regarding nutrition, again, both the documents, they talk about almost the same things. I'm so sorry I'm covering half of the slides here, but I hope you can somehow see. Maybe the camera can be adjusted. So it's all talking about antenatal nutrition, about exclusive breastfeeding, about complementary foods. From 6 months onwards, micronutrient supplementation, food safety and security, marketing regulations for baby formula, and mandatory food and beverage labeling. So, why do you think we should, who are the vulnerable population, and why we should target the vulnerable population? The poor, underprivileged, deprived, disadvantaged population, like children who are born in very poor, ultra-poor families, these are all very vulnerable for brain development. Children who are malnourished, we already talked about them. The refugees and displaced population, the world is actually going through a very difficult, critical period that we have almost millions and millions of displaced population, and here the children are suffering the most. So these are very vulnerable population. Then the children who are exposed to violence, maltreatment, neglect, these are also vulnerable. Children of depressed mothers, children whose mothers have some kind of mental illness or mental depression. And children who are exposed to environmental toxicants, and of course children with special needs. So why we should target these vulnerable children is because there are sensitive periods. We know that from conception, or of course nowadays we are saying preconception, up to 2 years of age, that's the first 1,000 days or maybe more, there is a sensitive period that the brain develops, and Aisha has shown a beautiful slide this morning from the brain development, at which period there is development of the brain structure. And then of course we know that different functions have different timing and duration. Some functions, as you have seen in the slide in the morning, some functions develop earlier, some develop later. So the insult at any point may have some long-lasting effects in future of the child. And the timing of the function, even if you start having some interventions, some of the children, some profoundly disadvantaged children, may not respond to the intervention equally if the intervention is like after 2 years of age, because that sensitive period has gone. And of course there are different adversities that affect different functions. For example, we have seen from the literature that children of depressed mothers, they have more of psychological problems in their adolescence. This is just a slide from our study in Bangladesh that shows how early the effects of poverty can be obvious. We have measured 1,579 children in a longitudinal cohort at 7 months, at 18 months, and then again at 5 years. And we looked at their development by the quintiles of socioeconomic condition, of the wealth quintiles. And we found that as early as at 7 months, there is a significant difference between the development of children in the richest quintile and in the poorest quintile. And as you can see from the slide here, the gap widens, and the developmental difference reaches almost 15 IQ points between the richest and the poorest population. So you see, this is how poverty, the socioeconomic condition, can affect a child's development as early as 7 months. And it, even the earlier, we don't know, because we haven't measured it earlier than 7 months. And this is also from the same study. This is showing you how length growth in length, and home stimulation, measured by home observation for measurement of environment, affects a child's development at 5 years. And here, as you can see, the highest effect size belongs to home at 18 months. So early stimulation from birth to 18 months has got the highest effect size on a child's development. And then, of course, linear growth from birth to 2 years is as important as home stimulation, and the other linear growth at birth or at up to 5 years, they also have some effect. And interestingly, we also found that there is a significant benefit of stimulation up to 5 years. We all thought that like by 3 years of age, maybe the effect of the stimulation is not there anymore, but even at 5 years, we found that stimulation, psychosocial stimulation at 5 years, can have a good effect on development of children. So, I have looked into the integrated approaches for early childhood development, and I found a number of studies that have reported all these approaches from integrated with ECD. There are a lot of studies on individual functions, but I am only talking about those that have integrated ECD with them. So, for example, the conditional cash transfer programs, there is some good amount of literature on conditional cash transfers on child development, but there are only 3 reports from studies that have included ECG with conditional cash transfer. And the results show that, so it's a bit, you can say, plus minus. In some studies, like in Colombia, they showed cognitive benefits to cognitive development and social-emotional skills. And again, in another study in Colombia, they found benefits to cognitive scores and receptive language, but unfortunately, the effects were not sustained 2 years after the intervention stopped. And in Mexico, there was effects to general cognitive index, verbal score, and memory score. There are a good number of interventions on maternal mental health, and some of them have shown positive results for child development. We know there are a lot more literature on effects of maternal depression on child growth and development, but interventions of that have integrated maternal mental health and child development show that there is a decline in maternal depressive symptoms, suppose in Jamaica, and improvement in children's development. In Pakistan, we see that there is decline in maternal depressive symptoms and better perceived social support. They didn't measure child development in Pakistan, but there was improvement in parent-child interaction. In South Africa, there was no significant improvement in maternal depression, but mothers were more sensitive and less intrusive in their interactions, and the infants were more securely attached. In Bangladesh, there was no significant improvement in maternal mental health, but there was some improvement in infants' cognitive, motor, and language development. There is also another unpublished study that we conducted in Bangladesh, where we joined maternal mental health intervention in terms of thinking health program and psychosocial stimulation. And here we also found a significant benefit to maternal mental health, maternal depressive symptoms, and also a benefit to children's cognitive development and emotion. Then there are some studies that have integrated prevention of violence. These are, some are home-based, some are teacher education programs, and they have found improvements in both child development and maltreatment outcomes. We also conducted another study that is not yet published in Bangladesh, and here also we integrated management of childhood maltreatment, maternal depression, and psychosocial stimulation. And we found a benefit to disciplining behavior of parents, behavior and maltreatment in case of parents, how they behave with the children. And it's very interesting to see that at baseline, the children were between 6 to 24 months, and at baseline, they were, there was no significant difference between the two groups in the control and intervention. At end line, when we measured the disciplining behavior of parents, the behavior increased, I mean the maltreatment or disciplining behavior increased in both the groups compared to baseline. But still there was a significant difference between the intervention and control group. And regarding the health interventions, I did not find any health intervention that had included ECD with health interventions, but there is just one paper that is recently published by my colleague Dr. Fahmida Tufail, and this in this study they found an improvement in the communication, language, motor, and personal social behavior of children at 2 years from interventions on water quality, sanitation, hand washing, and nutrition. All the interventions also reduced maternal depressive symptoms, and in some arms there were improvement in home environment. But interestingly, another sister study of similar design in Kenya did not have any effect on child development, it only affected growth of children. Then there are plenty nutrition nutrition interventions. We all know that malnutrition affects development. There are many nutritional interventions integrated with child development. This is from the famous Jamaican study on stunted children, and you can see that they had four groups of children who were stunted and a non-stunted group as comparison. And at the end of 2 years of intervention, the stunted children received both stimulation and food supplementation. They had almost caught up to the non-stunted children in their development. And then of course, this study has followed up the children up to 22 years of age, and they have found very fabulous results from this study, and they have shown that children who were stimulated, whether or not they received nutrition or not, food supplementation or not, they had benefits to their development compared to the control who did not receive stimulation. And there was also benefits to their results in school, in maths, general knowledge, in grade level, in they were less likely to be expelled from school, they had less depression, less better social behavior, and less violent behavior. And above all, they had higher wages from stimulation. And when you have seen Aisha's study, I don't need to talk about it again. This was also a very fabulous study that showed an effect of responsive stimulation with enhanced nutrition that improved children's cognitive, language, and motor development. And also at 4 years of age, 2 years after the intervention, right, there was an effect of responsive stimulation plus enhanced nutrition, or even responsive stimulation alone on children's cognition and executive functioning. This one is another replication of the Jamaican study that we did in Bangladesh. And here also we had like a group who had received stimulation, a group who had received food, and a group who received both. And they had, there was two control groups also. And here we found that children received stimulation, whether they had food supplementation or not, they improved in their mental development. And this is from our latest study in Bangladesh, where we included moderately and severely malnourished children in the community clinics in Bangladesh, and we provided psychosocial stimulation through the staff of community clinic who are government staff. In terms of maternal depression, again, we don't have enough studies. Same with health intervention, with water, sanitation, and hygiene. Responsive caregiving, I'm not going to discuss much about it. My next speaker is going to talk about it. And but it has shown benefits to child development. And I didn't find any literature on humanitarian efforts for refugees and displaced population. But there are some programs going on, and hopefully we will hear from them soon. So why aren't we doing this? We know that integration is good, we need it, but why we are not doing it? I think the first conclusion from the previous slide is that we still lack sufficient evidence. We also lack political will. I think I'm very impressed with Nepal here. I see that starting from the Prime Minister to other ministers and majority of people, the programs in Nepal have been really successful. But in a lot of other countries, we still require the political will to establish ECD, quality ECD, as a major factor for children's well-being. Then, of course, we don't have policies that can support us. There is a lack of funds, probably the governments, again, it goes to the political will, but also maybe the donor agencies can focus more on ECD. And there is a lack of public awareness. I I think there are still a lot of people who do not recognize the importance of early childhood development. So for call to action, I think we need policies, we need government sector collaborations and programs, and we need advocacy, research and advocacy. So for policies, we need good quality care, we need strategic direction of to support holistic development of children. We need to enhance the existing programs. We have a lot of existing programs, but they are not going on quite well. We need to have workplace policies so that, like daycares in the workplace, so that people can bring their children to the daycare, or they can have time off work when they have children, so they can take better care of their children in early days. I think the government's actions have been discussed in the morning plenty. One thing that I would like to focus here is the second point, to use the media to build awareness among parents and community. I always ask people if, like especially people in this region, if they know about Fair and Lovely. Is there anybody in this region who hasn't heard about Fair and Lovely? Or in case of men, Fair and Handsome? Yeah. Anybody here hasn't heard about it?
Yeah.
Please raise your hand. You have heard about it or haven't?
We have.
Okay. Why do we know so much about Fair and Lovely? I'm not propagating Fair and Lovely. I just want to make the point that it is the media. Media is such a strong force to establish things in the mind of people. And we are not using media well. The governments, all the governments, they have their own national television, national radio, they have national press media. Why don't we use this media to develop, to prepare people about early childhood development? And another thing I would like to focus is the identification of local champions. Now, these local champions can become the drivers of change in the community. They can start, the local champions can be like maybe the political leaders, they can be teachers, they can be local doctors, they can be religious leaders. Anybody who has some credibility in the community, we can identify them as local champions who can take the ECD forward. And of course, for research, we still have a long way to go about research. We need to find answers to a lot of research questions. We still don't know much about the frequency or intensity of the effective programs, at which age we should start, what should be the duration of the program, whether we should have in groups programs or individual one-on-one programs, whether we have to target the high-risk population or have a universal blanket program, whether these programs are sustainable and long-term, they show long-term benefits. Then we need to develop a culture-appropriate holistic package of ECD. Another thing that I have actually wanted here to focus more on it, to emphasize it, is that the holistic package needs to include moral and spiritual values, spiritual education. We were discussing about the conditional cash transfer with one of my colleagues yesterday in the airport, and we were saying that suppose people are receiving conditional cash transfer, I mean they are supposed to receive conditional cash transfer, but their name is enlisted and they have never received it. And we are thinking that, oh, okay, very good, this country has got cash transfer, conditional or unconditional. But and so we are hoping that the ECD will be successful there, but they have never received the cash. Where does the cash go? It's because we don't have that moral and spiritual values, we don't follow that. And so of course, people, they take benefit of that. And we need to have predictive validity of measurements, measurement tools, especially in low and middle income countries. A lot of measurement tools are developed for the Western population, and they are not quite useful for the developing countries, so we need to have some adapted tools, and we need to also ensure quality or fidelity of the intervention through evidence-based methods and develop monitoring tools. So I was asked to also relate it to SDGs, but we have already discussed about the SDGs in the morning. I'm almost done, thank you. So like the eradication of poverty, we know that if we develop, if we have a strong quality early childhood development in the country, the children will have better schooling, better outcome, they can have better jobs, they can contribute to the economy of the country, so the poverty can be eradicated. Similarly, hunger can be eradicated. If about goal number three, to ensure healthy lives, ECD can help reduce the incidence of non-communicable diseases and lower health costs by preventing violence, by improving mental health in the parents especially and in the children. And goal number four, we can ensure lifelong learning. ECD improves early learning and results in optimal learning and productivity later in life. And there is higher attendance in pre-primary education reduces dropouts in school. We have already heard about all this. And of course, clean water and sanitation, ECD can increase awareness in parents to provide access to clean water. To promote decent work for all, ECD will result in better educated and skilled people who can engage in more decent jobs. We can reduce inequality by reducing inequalities that begin at birth. We have just seen that poverty can affect development of children as early as at 7 months. And so to promote peaceful societies, ECD interventions lead to lower rates of violence in the home and greater social cohesion in the communities. So I just want to finish with this very favorite quotation of mine. This is from Baha'u'llah, the founder of Baha'i Faith. And he says that to regard man as a mine rich in gems of inestimable value. Education can alone cause it to reveal its treasures and benefit and enable mankind to benefit therefrom. So let's look at all the children like a mine that has got a lot of jewels in it, a lot of important inestimable gems in it, and we need to provide education to these tiny human beings to get the best benefit for the whole humanity. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hamadani. It was really heartwarming to listen to all the interventions that you were sharing with us so that the lives of young children and their families can be improved. And she advocates for us to use media to move the agenda for ECD, as well as to use local champions. And I'm sure you are the chief champion for Bangladesh. Thank you very much for your presentation.